know, the Russians talk about the wolves in the forests, and the old joke is, you know, tragedy, I suppose, is do you appease a wolf by throwing a baby to him, let him devour it, and then he'll lie down peacefully and not try to get another one? Well, that's what our diplomats are trying to figure out. The answer is Putin is a wolf, and he's going to devour whoever is given to him. And the more weakness, the more he will want more, then more and more and more, unless we stop him. We had that same thing I've mentioned in World War II, where Adolf Hitler started talking about the Sudeten Dutch and Deutsch and all this, that he's going to take care of the struggling Germans. And then after that, he started taking more territory, and the French and the British had enough arms in those days to make him stop. Hitler didn't have the power. Putin doesn't have the power either. He doesn't have any kind of an army. It's a joke. He doesn't have any air force. That's a joke. He has a lot of nuclear weapons, but he probably won't use those because we could destroy his country. So what's he doing? It's a bluff. But he succeeded in that bluff, and the more he takes, the more he'll want. So these people are meeting in Paris, and they're trying to put an end to this showdown nonsense. The more they give him, the more he'll want to take. Terry?
Well, Russia may intervene again after a sudden explosion of pro-Russian demonstrations across eastern Ukraine. George Thomas brings us the story from the city of Kharkiv.
We drove 6 hours from Kiev to the industrial heartland and Ukraine's second most populous city. Here, many ethnic Russians want nothing more than to see Moscow invade and take control of eastern Ukraine, as they did the Crimean Peninsula.
Only Russia's president, Vladimir Putin, can save us from the illegitimate government in Kiev.
For several hours Tuesday, riot police blocked all roads near Kharkiv's city hall, as pro-Ukrainian and pro-Russian demonstrators continued their almost daily face-off. Russia's decision to order troops involved in military exercises near the Ukrainian border back to their base angered many people here.
I'm very upset. I wanted those troops to attack, and I would have been the first one to welcome Russian tanks to this square with flowers.
This past weekend, dozens were injured when pro-Russian demonstrators stormed City Hall, replacing European Union flags with Russian ones, and called for union with Moscow. By late Monday, police had regained control of the building, and the Ukrainian flag flew once again. But it isn't stopping protesters.
The majority of the folks who have gathered here, many of them are pro-Russian, have called on their supporters to continue to gather in front of City Hall every night at 6 p.m. until this crisis is resolved in their favor.
How is the church praying today for...
Denis Sinelikov accuses Moscow of instigating the protests to create a reason for a broader invasion of Ukraine. Sinelikov, a Christian, was filming at a pro-Russian demonstration when police arrested him. We met him shortly after his release.
There is a majority of ethnic Russians who want Moscow to invade, but the majority of these protesters are being sent from Russia to stir up problems.
In the last few days, 11 cities have witnessed sudden eruptions of pro-Russian demonstrations.
At the borderline, a united country.
Something of extreme concern to Ola and Lena.
I just don't like it that we have so much hostility in our city. Somebody for Russia, somebody for Ukraine. I just don't like it. I want people to live in peace. We don't want war with Russia. We're brothers. We need to get along with each other.
Kharkiv is only 20 miles from the Russian border. President Putin said Tuesday he hopes he won't have to use force in this part of eastern Ukraine, but left all military options open to protect ethnic Russians from violence. George Thomas, CBN News, Kharkiv, Ukraine.
See, this isn't done isolated. It's not in a corner. So the whole world is watching. And they're saying, how is the U.S. going to react? We see how they reacted to Syria. We see how we reacted to Libya. We see how we've reacted in these various other situations. And there is a perceived weakness all over the world. And the time has come. It seems like to me, not only should we give some money, but it might be an important thing to have a squadron of our latest fighter planes fly into Kiev or someplace and say, listen, you're not going to get away with this, Mr. Putin, and we're tough, and we're going to make you behave. You know, the joke was when, you remember Jimmy Carter and that nonsense about staying in the Rose Garden because our embassy had been captured. The minute that Ronald Reagan got in, they said the cowboy's in the saddle. He's going to blow up our bazaar, and we'd better let those guys go. I mean, the minute he was inaugurated, they said, we've got a tough guy in Washington, and we can't play games with him. We can bluff Carter because he's weak. Well, they think they can bluff Obama because he's weak. Let's go now to our reporter, Chris Mitchell, to tell us what the reaction is, and John has more on that. Here's John.
That's right, Pat. And a former Israeli ambassador is warning that weakness from the United States is sending the wrong signal to many countries, including nations like Iran and North Korea. Chris Mitchell has that story from Jerusalem.
While the Ukrainian crisis pits the U.S., Europe, and the West against Vladimir Putin's Russia, Israel and Middle Eastern countries are watching closely.
A number of observers here in Israel believe that U.S. actions for the past several years, particularly in the Middle East, have set the stage for the current crisis in Ukraine.
There's no doubt that the severe erosion in the U.S. posture of deterrence, in the U.S. power projection throughout the world has triggered a much more audacious or emboldened Russia.
Former Israeli ambassador to the U.S. Congress, Yoram Ettinger, says perceived weakness in U.S. foreign policy has sent a message to the enemies of Israel and the U.S.
The chief trigger of more emboldened Russia, more emboldened Iran, China, North Korea, Venezuela, has been the recent engagement by the U.S. with Iran. Rogue regimes throughout the world notice the U.S. literally appeasing Iran.
Ettinger believes the world needs a strong USA.
For global sanity, we need a very exceptional USA. We need a very deterring USA, a less exceptional USA, a non-deterring USA only exacerbates the already insanity of the world.
As the crisis in Ukraine unfolds, U.S. foreign policy will be put to the test if it can stand up to the new threats in the 21st century. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Here in Washington, President Obama has come under fire for some of his nominees to represent America as ambassadors around the world. A union for foreign service workers is meeting to discuss its concerns about those nominees. As Jennifer Wishon reports, they're worried that sending unqualified ambassadors overseas will hurt America's economy and security.
It's been more than 20 years since the American Foreign Service Association weighed in publicly on a president's pick for an ambassadorship. The group serves as the union for America's foreign service workers. And after watching the recent confirmation hearings of President Obama's nominees, members couldn't stay silent.
The ambassador speaks for the U.S. government and the American people and the president.
Soap opera producer Colleen Bell nominated as ambassador to Hungary, hotel tycoon George Soonis nominated as ambassador to Norway, and political consultant Noah Mamet nominated as ambassador to Argentina. All earned their chances after bundling big money for the Obama campaign. But after watching their performances during their confirmation hearings on Capitol Hill, members of the association felt they had to speak up to keep Americans from getting ripped off.
Mr. Mehmet, have you been to Argentina?
Senator, I haven't had the opportunity yet.
There are a lot of markets that will continue to open up.
Well, let me just ask, as ambassador, how would you promote those trade cooperations?
Thank you for that save, Senator Johnson.
There were several moments when the nominees appeared to need saving, but critics argue the stakes at America's diplomatic post are too high for failure. Just look at the crisis in Ukraine.
37% of ambassadors appointed by President Obama have been political, but career diplomats say problems with political appointees didn't start with the Obama administration. And they say there are examples of America missing opportunities abroad because her top diplomat in the post wasn't qualified.
Other countries do not send campaign donors to the United States as ambassadors.
Federal law says campaign donations shouldn't be a factor in the selection of an ambassador. In an effort to encourage the selection of more qualified nominees, the association has spelled out a list of guidelines.
They're common sense. It's requiring leadership experience, understanding of the host country, the country to which you're being assigned.
It's the president's prerogative to nominate ambassadors and the Senate's prerogative to confirm them. But America's diplomatic community hopes these latest gaffes encourage whoever is in the White House to be more selective in these important choices in the future. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, Washington.
A German homeschooling family will be allowed to stay in the U.S. after all. The Supreme Court refused to hear an appeal from the Romeika family. Now the Department of Homeland Security announced the family has been granted indefinite deferred action status. That means the Romeikas can stay in the U.S. permanently unless they commit a crime or violate the terms of their status. The family fled Germany because the state threatened to take away their children if they did not enroll in public school. Well, the Obama administration is ready to announce another major delay in Obamacare. The Hill newspaper reports the White House will let insurers keep offering health care plans that don't meet the law's requirements. That will prevent another wave of policy cancellations this fall, weeks before the congressional elections. The move will help Democrats avoid more bad news over Obamacare. And right now, polls show Democrats could very well lose control of the Senate. Pat?
It's insanity, ladies and gentlemen, insanity. They pass a law. Not one Republican votes for the law. It's all a Democrat measure. So the thing is a monstrosity, and the American people are revolting against it. So instead of going to Congress and debating the issue, what they're going to do is have the president, by unilateral action, just change parts of it on his own. Now, that's unconstitutional. It shows an incredible disregard for the rule of law, for constitutional prerogative, the separation of powers, and all that other stuff that we think is important in our government. But why are they doing it? Because the law is so bad that if it's put in place before the election, a lot more people are going to vote against the Democratic nominees for Congress, especially the Senate. The House is in the hands of the Republicans, but the Harry Reid and his gang in the Senate have been able to block countless numbers of legislative initiatives just by not even having a vote on them. And so they want to hold control of the Senate. So if the Senate goes and the House goes, then Obama will be isolated. And he's doing everything he can. But this is naked politics, and it makes you sick at your stomach. John?
Pat, a diet heavy on meat and cheese could be very bad for your health if you're middle-aged. And get this, it could be as bad as smoking cigarettes. A study found middle-aged people who got most of their protein from animal sources, like meat and dairy, were four times as likely to die from cancer. But protein from plants didn't have the same effect. For older people, 66 and up, a high-protein diet turned out to be good. Older folks who ate a higher-protein diet were less likely to die from cancer. Researchers say diet can have a different effect at different stages of life, and they warn that middle-aged people need to be especially careful about too much meat and dairy. And Pat, the study's authors say most Americans eat about twice as much protein as they should.
Well, it depends on the protein. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to be an advocate for beans. Black beans, very good for you. But if the beans are matched with corn, you have a perfect protein. If you eat soybeans, and of course they've got some problems about estrogen with soybeans, but nevertheless, of the essential amino acids, you need 22 of them. Soybeans have 20 of the 22. So these plant-based proteins are very, very good for you. And a couple of days ago, I had the most delicious lunch. I opened a can of tuna fish, water-packed tuna fish.
Mm-hmm. That's good for you.
And I eat the can. All of it. And I had some hot sauce, and I had some other
hot sauce, really?
Tabasco, baby.
And, who knew?
and some other things, and salt and pepper and olive oil. And you mix it together, and it is delicious. And then you're eating fish. So they tell you to eat fish. Fish are good. So I take fish oil, and fish oil is good, too. Mm-hmm. But all these big, heavy steak things, but when you get older, you know, I don't know what middle age is today, but that's after 65, after 75, whatever. When you get older, then it doesn't matter, but you need your protein.
The right kind of protein.
The right
kind,
but they don't really care as long as it's protein. But in any event, what they're saying, the big news is that we've been bringing on this program over and over again, it's sugar that's killing you. Sugar is causing type 2 diabetes. Sugar is causing inflammation, and it's destroying people's lives, high blood pressure and all that stuff. And there's sugar everywhere, especially in sugared drinks.
Mm. But you can eat well and avoid it.
If you're me, you eat wonderfully well. Wonderfully well. You don't eat that much. There's only so much of that junk you can stand.
You're an encourager.
Oh, I'm an encourager.
And a bringer of wisdom.
Live long and be prosperous. Okay.
Kentucky will have to hire an outside attorney to appeal a recent court decision favoring gay marriage in the state. That's because Attorney General there says he will not fight the order recognizing same-sex marriages from other states and countries. A federal judge ruled last month Kentucky's voter-approved ban on recognizing such couples violates the Constitution. Tuesday, Kentucky Attorney General Jack Conway said to appeal that ruling would be to defend discrimination. The state's governor says he will hire outside counsel for an appeal. A veterans group is asking the U.S. Supreme Court to overrule an order removing a war memorial cross from a Southern California mountain. In 2011, a federal court ruled the cross was unconstitutional because it's an endorsement of Christianity on federal property. Last December, a district judge ordered the cross removed in 90 days. The Mount Soledad Memorial Association is asking the 43-foot cross remain atop the mountain in San Diego. The veterans group says appealing straight to the Supreme Court, it hopes will quickly resolve the case. Remember, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.